humanity has the potential to follow many future roads. What I mean is that, we humans seem to be following a direct line, where our past pushes us forward in a certain inevitable direction, in a certain and most expected direction. But there are other alternatives, other roads, other futures, other alternate life tracks that we can travel down as a species. For the most part, we all perceive and believe, being that we have completely focused ourselves in the existential possibility of time as being only a linear and sequential thing, that there's only one future for us, that this future is pretty much a guaranteed thing within the parameters that we feel to be possible. Certainly, there are times when we might say that this particular event in our history might have changed what we became. We may say that this battle, this particular theology, this new law and set of principles that was created at this time in the past, changed aspects of our present and the future. But generally speaking, we believe that the future is set. There's only one possible future for humanity, because whether we like to admit it to ourselves or not, we tend to have the idea that our future is very much set, just like our past, that ultimately neither the past nor our future can be really changed. This belief has to do with the linear idea of time. We think, oftentimes quite unconsciously, that since the past is unchangeable, the future is as well. We often make brave speeches as to how we can all change, how we will get better, but really, unconsciously for the most part, we have a sense that the future is set as well. We also tend to presuppose that since time only moves forward, evolution is also only a forward-moving vehicle. Therefore, what came before, the past, is lesser than what we have now. And of course, this also means that our future must be better, because it will be more evolved than the past, so it must be better. And that this betterment must involve a technological evolution in a very particular direction. And yet, it is this very modern insistence on a linear time model that actually creates this inevitable future, because awareness shapes reality, not the other way around, and our current awareness, so focused on mechanical and linear conceptions, can only create a very limited range of future possibilities. And those possibilities seem to all involve an external device-driven science. But is this particular evolution to a technological super-device-filled science really inevitable? Well, this future is inevitable only because this is how we view time, and how we perceive and work with time tells us everything that we need to know about how humanity views and works with causality. What I mean is that, because we believe in linear time, because we believe that time is a force, a thing outside ourselves, we believe in a cause before an effect, we believe that all things, including all change, happens outside, beyond us, outside us, and therefore, our technological advancements must follow such laws, which means that only one type of technology is most likely possible, and that this technology is mechanical in nature. You hit this and this hits that, which does this, and all such cause and effect happens outside ourselves. But such a causal understanding not only limits the potential capabilities of human technologies, it also limits the power that is available for us to work with and infuse into these technologies. Further, our causal order, due to our limited perception of time, also regulates our understanding of ourselves and the other. We believe that all things are external to us, that we are surrounded by things. Our technology, therefore, is a technology of external devices, external contraptions of all sorts. By limiting our ideas of time, we limit our potential. It is the case, therefore, that many people tend to think in a rather black and white manner about what we can do, about what is possible for us as human beings. Our future is set, therefore. There's nothing else but this possibility. We are quite literally stuck. As such, the majority of us tend to believe that we will either blow ourselves up due to some catastrophic war or natural event, or we are bound to move to the stars and become some spacefaring civilization, akin to something that you might see in a typical sci-fi or cyberpunk movie. But there are different ways to perceive, and therefore eventually to work with time. There are other causal structures that we can begin to work with, if we are willing to at least soften some of our very rigid current conceptions of reality. At this point in history, though, our technological growth, our evolution, must be more external devices and better machines. Machines, after all, are the future, and the future is better. It is evolution. And it is therefore not only prudent, but inevitable, that these external machines and devices end up actually becoming part of ourselves, end up becoming actually attached contraptions, machines in our brains or our bodies, until eventually we too must become partially or mostly machine ourselves. Machines are the future, so they are better. We must therefore become better by becoming more like machines. Our human future is a future filled with artificial intelligence, computers of increasing complexity and power, electronic implants, robotics that do most of our work, and a future humanity that looks more and more like a dystopian cyberpunk world. In this future world, there seems to be this push more and more lately towards a more commune or community-based human reality, where individuality and many of its inherent freedoms must be given up so that more orderly, more machine-like, that is, communities may be established. A new future where people may well need to become more like drones in a hierarchical order, instead of individual beings pursuing their own individual interests. While it is the case that many argue that there will be ways to escape this drone-driven future, this future civilization, perhaps by escaping from the clutches of large organizational governmental structures perhaps, the reality is that most technology is in the hands of large corporations and organizations that will make such escape as difficult as possible. In order to study this potentiality, we can review what has already happened with the smartphone. While it is possible to have a phone connected independently to the global network, no contract or planned connection, this ability is becoming more and more difficult over time, and it is getting to the point where it is not even possible to open up many of these smartphones without wrecking the equipment itself or facing some kind of fine for tampering. Such increasing control over the technology of smartphones, and the increasing complexity and intrusion possible by the many applications, apps, available to smartphones, makes it easy to see that the promise of power and privilege of the smartphone comes with a great cost, and that cost is individual freedom. Many may argue that such freedoms are really just an intrusion into personal privacy and not control, but such people are deluding themselves into thinking that all of this information that is gathered cannot be used to later create passive control techniques, that in time may nudge and sometimes even force them into certain directions and actions. In other words, the great control of mass information allows for the control of the masses. Now many of are talking and working on a future where a smartphone-like device, or at least a device that could interact with a smartphone, could soon be attached to the human brain. Imagine then all of the different difficulties that we now face, as far as security and personal freedoms just with smartphones that are in our pockets. What might our future be like when the smartphone is actually in our skull? Who will control the design and the functional parameters of that hardware and software that will go into those embedded computer devices? It is not my desire in this video to create some kind of angst against future technological endeavors. I personally find that much of our technology is very useful, and as a modern person, I too have benefited from this technological advancement. But I do believe that there is the possibility of an encroaching future that we might not want, and as such, I am asking, is it possible to find different ways to offset that future? At least a small part of that future, one where such devices become part of our brain. Well, one possible way is to expand our conception of reality and to develop a different type of technology, a technology that I am calling mental science or mental technology. Such a technology would need to be able to create all of the things required from the mechanical one. In short, it would need to provide for us anything that we have been able to do for ourselves through our modern conception of technology. But doing this through a wholly different kind of technology, a mental technology where no external devices are needed, and everything is done and created through the power of the mind, through a power and an understanding, a technology that can allow the whole of the human race to create with just the mind, to do with just the mind, and not with external devices based on purely mechanical understandings of causality. When we think of time as being a linear and sequential thing, we do so because our minds have been conditioned for a very long time to think this way, for such a long period of time actually that to think anything else is considered lunacy, and for such a long time that our external senses, our physical senses, are only allowed perceptions that fit within the parameters of this understanding, of this belief. Such conditioning has given birth really to the modern technological world, and as I have said, this modern world is a device-driven mechanical one. As to what this mental science might look like and what it could provide in the short term, well, In my books, I write about a very old other type of technology, a mental science that I refer to as inner alchemy. Such a mental science states that time is not linear at all. It states that time is actually a thing that exists all here and all now, that it is an infinite moment point that contains within it both what we think of the past and the future events. As such, our ability to alter, to see, to work with both the past and the future is in some ways more complex and in others far easier than we might imagine. Such a conception of time as being an ever-present event opens up the mind to new possible directions, to new causal laws, and therefore new potential technologies that do not need to focus so exclusively on the current causal framework that posits that time can only exist as a straight line from a past to a future. What might be possible? Well, it may be too late in our history to change completely and to begin a new type of probable world where mind science dominates everything, but we might still be able to use some of that causal understanding from this alternate form of science to offset the encroaching surrendering of individuality that a purely mechanical and device-driven technology is creating. We could, for example, delay or permanently change the need to have mechanical and electric devices implanted in our brains. Instead of needing electronic inputs plugged into our heads so that we might experience virtual realities and download information, we could instead learn to access different dimensional existences, different modes of mental perceptive points, so that we may expand our awareness enough that such external and invasive devices and contraptions would not be necessary. At the least, limit these until it is or it becomes absolutely necessary to use them to maintain or repair biological functions in people with disabilities. Through the ability to control personal awareness, we could perform any of the things that implants promise to provide a healthy body and mind. We could communicate telepathically, access infinite information, manipulate external objects, experience a far more powerful kind of internal reality, not through virtual environments, but through the ability to move, quite literally, across many dimensions, across real and complete other worlds. And in mastering all of this mental ability, we could grow intellectually in ways that I believe would surpass any physical computer or general intelligence network. It is my personal belief and personal perceptions that such a technology does exist and has existed on this planet in our past, a past where the modern linear conception of time did not rule the human psyche. And I do believe that snippets, that clues to such mental science can be found if we are willing to look deeply within available data on the subject, and are willing to work with as much diligence, using scientific principles on it, as we now do in other scientific and technological directions. Using the techniques of inner alchemy, it is possible to be able to acquire incredible amounts of knowledge, and to free ourselves to an incredible extent from the three-dimensional world that binds us, from the mechanical world of linear time that seems to be choking our individuality more and more, as we move seemingly forward through time. It is possible for us as human beings to be able to experience unbelievable other spaces and other worlds, and it is possible for us to do this naturally through a kind of mental science, instead of, for example, losing ourselves in a particular virtual reality video game or headset. Certainly, these techniques are not plug and play like most of our modern electronic devices, but you may find that the work required to develop these abilities may also have other benefits, such as expanding your own idea of self and of the possible freedoms that we do have access to now, as individuals. If you would like to explore the potential of such a mental science, and in particular, this ability to travel and to do and know in dimensions beyond conception, then I would recommend to you my book, Out of Body Experiences Quickly and Naturally. And if you are interested in very advanced techniques and methodology in this area, then I would recommend The Way of the Projectionist.